Well, good evening, everybody, and thank you for joining us for the introduction of the 2006 3 Series. As you know, there are few introductions that would be more important to a company like BMW than the introduction of an all-new 3 Series. So for us, this is a very important event, and we thank you very much for taking the time to be with us here this evening. In a moment, I'd like to do some introductions of the folks that are working behind the scenes to make this event so successful, and I'll also talk about the speakers that will be speaking here with us this evening. But before I do that, I feel compelled to address the question that has been on almost everybody's mind since we sent the first notifications of this event. Pittsburgh? Why Pittsburgh?
Some of us from Pennsylvania have no doubt why.
Well, there you go. Well, I should just say, ask John and leave it at that. But for the benefit of those of you that don't understand the city, much like the BMW 3 Series, this city in and of itself has a very rich and unique history. Fort Duquesne Boulevard, just along here in the hotel, of course named for Fort Duquesne, which was a very pivotal site during and the lead up to and the actual English and French War that took place in this country. In fact, before the war started, a young ensign was dispatched to have a quick word with the French, a young ensign by the name of George Washington, who came to kindly ask the French to vacate, to which the French oddly said, no. In that time, there have been many other things about this area and Pittsburgh that have made it very, very unique and very, very famous. In fact, as you probably noticed from walking around, even on the second floor of the hotel, in this hotel in and of itself, for example, was built, as some of you may have seen from the literature that we sent to you, was built 100 years ago. It was originally named for the founder of the building, a famous steamship baron. And the theme of barons running through to people like Carnegie, Mellon, and the like, as well as the Hineses, makes it important as well. There's always one in a crowd, isn't there? And even today, this city is home to a number of famous people, people like the actor Jimmy Stewart, people like the composer Henry Mancini, and people like the artist Andy Warhol, who himself has a connection to BMW, of course, because in 1979, he painted a BMW M1, one of the art car series that raced in Le Mans in the 24 hours in 1979. And in fact, tomorrow we will actually visit the Andy Warhol Museum here in Pittsburgh, which is in itself the largest museum dedicated to a single artist in the country. So a very interesting place, and very much, as you'll see, very much in the vein of Andy Warhol. Besides that, as you'll see on our trip tomorrow to Beaver Run Raceway Motorsport Complex, the roads around here are just spectacular. So as is typical of a BMW launch event, the driving will be par excellence. These kinds of events, as I've said before, take a lot of hands to make work. And I'd like to, before I introduce our speakers, just acknowledge some of the folks behind the scenes working diligently to make this happen. People like our group communications manager, Michael McHale. People like our press fleet manager, the guy you all like, our new press fleet manager, Vincent Kung. People like our corporate communications specialist, Diane Clancy. Our newest member to the product communications team, Bill Scully, whom some of you have had a chance to meet. And of course, there are people that make these operations run smoothly and on track and without whom they couldn't possibly happen. And for us, that person is our corporate communications specialist, Laura Lapones. This evening, you'll hear from a variety of speakers because, of course, as I said, this car has a very rich and unique and interesting history. First, you'll hear from our manager of corporate communications, Rob Mitchell, who will tell us a little bit about how the 3 Series fits in the grand scheme from a business perspective for BMW, but also, and very fittingly, because I can't think of a better person to do it, will give us a bit of a historical perspective on the 3 Series as well. We're also very pleased to have a gentleman with us here all the way from Munich, Dr. Wolfgang Eppler, who is the director of the 3 Series, the man behind the development of the car itself, who will speak to us a little bit about the car and how it got to be the way it is. And while there's a lot of us that would like to claim this mantle in this room tonight, I have to say that the guy who is probably the single biggest 3 Series fan in the room, our 3 Series product manager, Ken Brock. We have lots to talk about and lots to see and do over the course of the next couple of days, so without further ado, I would like to turn the floor over to Rob Mitchell.
Great. Is the mic on? The mic is on. Great. As Dave said, this is obviously one of the most important launches of the year, but before we head off and find out what's so interesting about the new car and why it's raised the benchmark, I wanted to let you know that there's also a few other things going on at BMW, and I didn't want them to be sort of pushed into the background as we focus on a really important vehicle like this. Any of you who were picked up at the airport today were probably picked up in the Refresh 7 Series, which is just coming into the market now. This has all new engines. It has 5-liter V8 engines in the 750i and 750iL. There's fresh in design, there's changes in technology, there's changes in the iDrive. So a lot's going on with that vehicle, and it is the most successful 7 Series that we've ever offered in the U.S. market and globally. Also coming just about this time of the year are two new offerings in the 5 Series. First, we've got the newest 5 Series wagon, which will be coming as an all-wheel drive vehicle, the 530XI. We've also got this X-Drive all-wheel drive system coming in the 5 Series sedans as well, both the 525XI and the 530XI. In the fall, we'll have our first extension to the 3 Series range, and we won't even get that far yet, but just want to let you know that the 3 Series wagon will come in the fall, as well as all-wheel drive for the 3 Series. We'll also have another car that I think a lot of you would probably love to get your hands on. That's the new 500 horsepower V10 powered M5. And that's going to be followed up late next spring, probably closer to May, by the M6 with the same drivetrain. So really an awful lot going on this year and well into next year besides just the 3 Series. Now, before I turn it over to my colleagues who are going to give you the details about the vehicle, I'd like to tell you about some numbers that might put into perspective how significant a vehicle the 3 Series is, both for us here in the U.S. and for BMW globally. First of all, 3 Series accounts for somewhere between 40 and 45% of worldwide sales. So obviously the launch of any new 3 Series generation, it's a very important launch for BMW. But it also accounts for over 500,000 cars sold every year by BMW. With all the variations of the 3 Series, over 500,000 cars globally every year. In the US alone, it's over 100,000. So obviously that's a very significant car. And in its fifth generation now, we're talking 30 years of success and being the benchmark in the compact sports sedan category. And if you count the predecessor, the 02 Series, the 2002, we're talking almost 40 years of leadership in this particular category. And one of the final numbers that sort of puts that in perspective, if you start with the 02 Series and go up to the current generation, more than 10 million 3 Series and 02 Series cars have been sold worldwide. So that's there's a lot of cars out there that are more mainstream, that are less expensive, that don't come anywhere near to those kind of numbers. So for something that should be somewhat of a niche vehicle, the 3 Series has done very well. Now what I'd like to do next is take a look at, to put this in perspective, is to take a quick run through of the heritage of the 3 Series. And I think this slide kind of says it all. When the 02 Series was launched and went into the first 3 Series, we were talking one model with a four-cylinder engine. Those were two-door models with four-cylinder engines, and they embodied the sports sedan concept. And yet, they've grown today to this vast array, this 3 Series family. The appeal has been broadened because of all of the various models and engines and configurations that we have marketed in more than 130 countries throughout the world. Now, we didn't start off, you know, with this in modern times in the way that you might think is logical. If we look at the 1950s, this was a time when BMW was looking for a formula for success. Before the war, they had had a lot of sports cars, the 328, they'd been very successful in racing. But in the 1950s, they were in a period of economic recovery. They wanted to return to those glory days. They were building cars like the 507 and the 503, expensive, admired vehicles, but there wasn't a big market for them at that time. So on the other hand, they said, well, let's try something that's more affordable for the masses. So things like the Isetta from BMW were also, you know, built and offered to the markets. They put a lot of vehicles out there, but they didn't make a lot of money for the company. So the company really struggled financially. And at the end of the 50s, BMW nearly went bankrupt. In 1959, they were on the block. And it was only at the last minute that Herbert Quandt stepped in and bought the majority share in the company that gave them the funds needed to develop the current generation of cars that we have today. So as we entered the 60s, BMW was on the verge of launching the predecessors to the four major series we have today, the 3, the 5, the 7, and the 6 series. All of those predecessors are launched in the 1960s. Now, here's where the sports sedans concept started. It actually was just before the 2002. In the early 1960s, BMW launched a car called the 1500. It was a four-door sedan, it was a mid-sized car, but it had features that weren't normal in sedans at that time. It had an overhead cam engine with a cross-flow cylinder head. It had disc brakes. It had fully independent suspension front and rear. Had a four-speed synchronized manual transmission. These weren't typical sedan features of the day. The sports sedan concept was born. But again, this wasn't quite a car for the masses, and BMW wasn't quite yet recognized as the purveyor of this concept. What happened was the next step in this, and that was when they decided to build a smaller two-door version. This was the 02 series. This was the predecessor to the first model actually called a 3 series. It was launched with the 1600cc engine, so the first model launched was the 1600. It was launched in the U.S. as a 67 model. The idea was they took the same engines in the larger four-door, put them in a compact two-door, and voila, you know, Pocket Rocket was born. But what really brought that concept to fruition was when they put the largest, the 2-liter engine in it, and particularly in the U.S. market. That vehicle arrived in 1968, and the 2002 has become a cult car and a legend ever since then. They went on to add, let's go to the next slide, they went on to add larger engine variations. 2002, they had the fuel-injected 2002 TII. In Europe, they built a 2002 Turbo in very limited quantities. They continued their success in motorsports. And at that time in the U.S., the 2002 accounted for about 80% of our sales. So you can understand that it was a very significant car in the early days of BMW's offerings in the U.S. By the time its 10-year model run was done and we were ready to launch the first three series, over 100,000 of them had been sold in the U.S. Then, in model year 77, we launched the first 3 series, the first one to actually have the name 3 series. Again, it was just a two-door, and in the U.S. market, it was just a four-cylinder, yet the success of that car went even beyond the 2002. We sold 171,000 of them during a 7-year life cycle. It continued its success in motorsports. Many of you may remember the 320i Turbo, driven by David Hobbs in the IMSA GT series. This was actually the test bed for the Formula One engine. It had a 1.5-liter four-cylinder engine that was turbocharged and putting out some enormous horsepower and causing a lot of excitement and winning a lot of races. 1984, we launched the next generation here. This is what we call internally E30. What was really significant about this generation is We expanded the 3 Series model range for the first time. We went beyond just having 4-cylinder engines. We added the first 6-cylinder engines in the 3 Series. We also added a lot of body style variations. The first 4-door came very early on in that life cycle. The first convertible came. We launched the first M3 based on that. In total, we sold in the U.S. 370,000. So you can see how much the appeal of the 3 Series went up just by adding a lot of variations and by the legend of the 3 Series growing. We also added an all-wheel drive, the 325 iX in that generation. When we went to the next generation, which we call E36, which was introduced as a 1992 model, that sort of set the stage for the current process, introducing a 3 Series initially as a 4-door and then adding the other model variations. Also significant when we went to the E36 was the change in design. We kind of went away from the 3-box design, school of design from BMW, and went to something much more aerodynamic, much more elegant, much more modern. And you can see throughout the various body styles, coupe, convertible, the 318 Ti hatchback, that it was a body style that really lent itself to a significantly broader appeal. That model during its life cycle sold 357,000. This was also the model that launched our 10-year string of success in racing in the U.S. Together with the company PTG, we started racing in 95, and we've been at it together for 10 years with lots of success. The fourth generation continued that formula, launching in model year 99, first as a 4-door sedan, and then going on to add coupe, convertible, M3. This expanded to almost 600,000 sales during its life cycle. We brought back all-wheel drive again in both sedan and wagon formats. And it's been the most successful generation. So this is what has brought us up now to the launch of the current generation, which we're going to show you and tell you about here in just a second. Before Dr. Epple comes up to tell you a little bit, we've got a very short video. You'll actually see him here in the video as well. So if you'll just focus your attention here. And last thing, 10 million sold over that period of time.
We wanted to get the best synthesis between dynamics on the one hand side and riding comfort on the other side.
I think the serious buyers that I have, the kind of guys that have the performance package on the current 330, those guys want more acceleration, but they don't want to lose the handling that the car's famous for.
You sit in the car, you press the pedal down to the bottom, and you feel directly and immediately the acceleration of the car.
You should think that's the perfect driving machine, which has the best power and driving results possible at getting this class of cars.
We have a lot of different terrains, different mountain passes that we drive through, and as far as handling, I think the wider track in the vehicle is going to be outstanding.
Das, was geschafft haben, dass wenn der Kunde mit dem Auto nach Hause gefahren ist und das Auto abstellt.
When the customer drives home, he or she doesn't think about whether we have the best acceleration or the best steering feedback. That customer is thinking, my BMW drives better than any other car.
They want to feel the way that the car drives and be one with the car.
A
besser definiert über seine.
BMW has always been defined by its drivability, by its agility.
Anbieten kann und von daher können wir.
The new 3 Series offers excellent stability and superior handling over its competitors. The safest car in its class. The B column is very strong. It supports and distributes the load evenly from the back to the front. We tried to do better than the regulatory requirements of the side impact crash.
Well, I think that's the ultimate. That's why they come back to BMW, is because BMW has always had one of the safest vehicles on the road.
Excellent stability and superior handling over its competitors. Our improved rigidity provides a very high level of protection. The E90's impact performance should be considerably improved. That means the new E90 will achieve the highest marks in meeting occupant protection standards. This vehicle has more safety features than before. Its structure and safety features protect our occupants better in the event of an accident.
I like the fact that it's roomier. I think it's going to bring this a lot more customers.
BMW has always been defined by its drivability, by its agility. But we also include comfort for our drivers and passengers as well. I think we offer a product range that really covers the whole spectrum, from sports features to luxury.
It's more luxurious on the inside.
Increasing the comfort of the driver. Stiff bodies mean riding comfort.
It's got a lot more room than the old 3 Series car.
Surely one feature that has been improved is the E90's dimensions, especially the interior. We've improved on nearly all the dimensions within the interior of the car. We have also improved considerably on the interior options that are available.
Cost of ownership, where the other model might be maybe less expensive in the purchase price, but cost of ownership might be a lot more expensive.
The fact that BMW is committed to maintain the car for 4 years, 50,000 miles from when they take delivery.
With BMW taking the full maintenance program aspect, I think that's eased a lot of customers' minds.
I think the maintenance end of it is a huge, huge, huge aspect that I'm not sure we bring up enough.
Of the most luckiest individuals here in this room for two reasons. Number one, because you, the powerhouse of the American motoring press, our guest here tonight. And number two, because I've been given the task to develop the new 3 Series 2.5 years ago by the board of BMW AG in Germany. 30 years of heritage. Fifth generation, the requirements have been extremely conflicting. Sporty, yet convenient. Dynamic, yet efficient. Uncompromising, yet versatile. The concept BMW 3 Series presents to the market had to improve, had to be refined once again. Ladies and gentlemen, psychologists say that the years between 30 and 40 are the most interesting years, the most challenging, the most thrilling, simply, the best years in the life of a human being. And the same is true for the new 3 Series BMW. Fifth generation, 30 years of heritage,
it's really something. And I promise you, it's the best BMW 3 Series we have ever put onto the road. Statistically, people grow in average 1 millimeter per year. And that is why the new 3 Series got 6 millimeter taller in height, or 0.8 of an inch. It got 3 inch wider and 2.2 inches longer. 40% out of that additional length we have spent as additional legroom for the rear passenger. Another 40% we put as additional luggage space into the boot. And the remaining 20% we invested in safety. That growth of the car is encapsulated in a new BMW typical design. It has got the typical elements, the short overhang in front, the long bonnet, which hides the six-cylinder engine. The greenhouse has been moved rearward. And in silhouette, there are the typical BMW character lines. On the bottom, the line which is ascending from front to rear. And at the door handle, the BMW typical character line, which is powerful, underlined with concave and convex surfaces. On the top, there's that long line which gives the car the elegance. Those three lines combine harmoniously in the rear end, which is a powerful, typical BMW rear end. It has got the typical L-shaped tail light. In the interior, the concave convex surfaces have been taken up in the dashboard. The dashboard is driver-oriented. It consists of the driving zone and the comfort or convenience zone. The driving zone includes all the elements for display and control for the driver. And the comfort zone is both for the driver and the passenger. The dashboard comes in two different alternatives. With a single or double binnacle, you get the double binnacle whenever you select the navigation system. The interior is of high quality. There are three different trim panels to select from, aluminum and two wood panels, leather or leatherette seat covers, and up to 8 different colors to select from for the interior. But for a human being, the heart is, that is for BMW, the motor, the engine. And what could better symbolize that powerful, silky engine than that new start-stop button? A gentle push onto the button whistles, blows life into the car. The life comes from the different engines, and this year, the new BMW 3 Series is launched all over the world with 7 different engines. 4 four-cylinder engines, 3 six-cylinder engines, or 4 petrol engines and 3 diesel engines. The top of the range, the cherry of the cake, is introduced here in the United States, the new six-cylinder engine. This inline six-cylinder is the first off in industry because it uses the precious material, magnesium, for the bed plate and for the crankcase. This gives the engine substantial more power, 30 horsepower in addition, increased torque, and yet reduces the weight of the engine by more than 20 pounds. BMW's competence is the drive, the chassis, and the body. The chassis comes with a brand new rear axle, a 5-link lightweight steel construction, an aluminum front axle, a double joint tension strut front axle. And additional systems, like a new DSC system, support the chassis. That chassis is bolted to the body. And ladies and gentlemen, everybody knows growth usually means increase of weight. However, we would not be BMW if we wouldn't have found a solution for that one. Though we have implemented a body which is 25% more stiff, more rigid than the previous one, has got all the preconditions in order to achieve the highest rating in international safety standards, and still is roughly 10 pounds lighter than the previous one. The total car, if you compare it on an equal option basis, has got less weight than the previous one. The whole concept of a BMW, the inline six-cylinder engine in front, the rear-wheel drive, the almost equal weight distribution, 50% in front, 50% in the rear, and the stiff, rigid body, that is what makes the typical BMW driving behavior, the driving fun, the easy controllability, the traction which you get all the time on the tires, the feedback you get from the road, and the safe driving. Agile, dynamic on one hand side, convenient, comfortable on the other side. To summarize, ladies and gentlemen, the new 3 Series is a major step in the concept. The most successful concept in the industry has once again been refined and improved to a higher level. Secondly, new technologies and innovations, which were so far only offered in the other segment, like active steering, have been transformed and refined to the 3 Series, to the middle class. And thirdly, the car comes with a higher level, top quality interior trim. Ladies and gentlemen, this car has got all the genes and the preconditions to be once again the leader in the industry. Thank you very much.
And now I would like to hand over to Ken Kraft,
who is going to give you the details of the car. Ken.
Sure. Well, thank you, Dr. Epley. For those of you who are going to be spending some time with us, obviously most of you will be here the next day and a half. I really encourage you to talk to Wolfgang. He's a wealth of knowledge, knows a lot of detailed specifications for the vehicle, and is very interesting to talk to. But anyway, as Dave Butchko was giving the introduction, he mentioned me as one of perhaps the biggest series fan in the room. And I began to reminisce and think about that a little bit. And it's kind of interesting that actually the first BMW I ever drove was an ink and orange 2002. And the second one I drove was a 320i. So how appropriate for the two first BMWs I was ever to drive to then eventually become the 3 Series manager. And I think what really drew me to BMW was they were really icons for the way they drive. And the 3 Series is an icon for the way it drives. I mean, it really combines everyday drivability with agility, a car that really handles like a sports car. In this new 3 Series, we've really built on the same core concepts that made the predecessors successful. We've improved on the engines. We've made it handle better. We've introduced new advanced technology and offered more options and features, including safety features, than ever before. But we're Bavarian Motor Works, so let's talk about the new engines. Wolfgang talked about how we really get the cherry on the top here in the U.S. market, and that's true. The 325 and the 330 are the two models that we'll offer in this market. The 330 increases 30 horsepower to 255 horsepower. The 325 improves 31 horsepower from 184 to 215 horsepower. So about 13% increase on the 330i. Also nice, that torque band comes in a little lower, just below 3,000 RPM. So what are the 0 to 60 times? That's usually the soundbite that everybody likes to have. The 325 0 to 60 in 6.7 seconds, a significant improvement over its predecessor. And the 330i accelerates with a manual transmission, a six-speed manual transmission, in 6.1 seconds. What's also impressive is if you look at the times of the automatics, and they're now a six-speed Steptronic automatic, 6.3 seconds for the 330i. That actually out-accelerates the old 330i manual transmission at 6.4. So these new automatics get a lot of power to the ground, and they're quicker than the old ones. I think that's personally impressive. What else have we done? Well, in this current environment of high gas mileage, we've also been able to improve the fuel economy. And we've been able to do this with Valvetronic. And Valvetronic is really an amazing engineering technical solution to what at first you would think would be two opposing goals: more horsepower and better fuel economy. But we've been able to do it. In fact, on this new 3 Series on the highway with a manual transmission, you can get up to 30 miles per gallon. What else have we done? Well, I mentioned handling. So what we've done is we've taken some of the technology and some of the things that we've learned on the 5, 6, and 7 Series and brought them to the 3 Series. Front aluminum double pivot strut type suspension is now on the 3. And the other thing that we've done significantly is we've changed the rear suspension. It's no longer a multi-link or a four-link rear suspension. It's now a five-link rear suspension. What else have we done? We've advanced the technology, offering more options that have typically only been available on 5, 6, and 7 Series. This first one, something called active steering that you're probably familiar from the 5. The consumer benefit of this technology is really low-speed agility and high-speed stability. Now, BMW picks on our standard steering, picks a ratio that's very good, but it still has to be a compromise because you have to have, obviously, something that works well at low and high speed. Active steering is really the solution to get that almost Formula One type in terms of how much the wheels turn for the given steering input at low speeds, medium speeds, and then have something that's relatively stable. Obviously, you wouldn't want that same ratio at 100 plus miles per hour. Next thing I'd like to talk about is something called active cruise control. When you compare this to conventional cruise control, it's really an amazing thing because I think that we've all experienced it. Imagine that you're on a relatively long highway jaunt, say from DC to New York, or New York to Boston, or LA to San Francisco. You're in the left lane, cruising along. See if I catch up with my timing here. And actually, somebody has pulled into the left lane in front of you. What the system will do is use radar to determine how far you are from that vehicle, slow you down, and then hopefully when that person gets back into their lane, in the right lane, right, then the system will recognize that that lane is open, and then you'll go back to that preset distance. I mean, that's a lot better than constantly disengaging the cruise control, which is what you have to do today. The other feature I'd like to talk about is navigation with iDrive. And this picture right here is what the conventional dashboard looks like, but when you get navigation, it comes with iDrive and voice command. And I actually think that, and it's a $2,000 option. And this is actually, I think, incredible value because the E46, the previous model, was $1,800. And for that additional $200, in addition to the typical navigation benefits that you have, but you also get the additional climate controls with iDrive, the additional computer controls with iDrive, and then, of course, the ability to operate the vehicle or operate the controls in the vehicle with voice command. Next, I'd like to talk about some of the safety features on this new 3 Series. Now, when the predecessor came out, the E46, as we call it, in model year 1999, it was the first vehicle in its class to have front head protection system. On this all-new 3 Series, this 2006 model, we've now extended the front head protection system to the rear as well. The other thing that we've done, and Wolfgang and I have had some interesting conversations on this, is that we've moved the front side airbag. They're no longer door mounted. They're now mounted within the seat. And the reason that we did that is that now that airbag is situated to be in the optimal position no matter how that seat has been adjusted. Also, because it's now on the seat, we can make it the airbag itself a little bit smaller, because when we didn't know where people had their seat adjusted, we had to make it larger. That's been, it enabled us to reduce a little bit of weight there and also give us a little bit more room to sculpt out that door, so you have a little bit feeling more of an airy feeling. What else have we done? We have done quite a bit with the brakes, but before I get to the brakes, I want to talk about run flat tires. The Z4 was one of our first cars that had run flat standard across the board. The 3 Series will have run flat tires across the board, both base and sport package. And the main consumer benefit of this technology, first, when you do get a run flat or you get a flat tire, you can drive up to 150 miles at 50 miles per hour. And the benefit is that you never have to change a tire in the wrong place, whether that be on the side of a highway with traffic zooming by at 55 miles per hour plus, or if you're in a bad neighborhood. And then sometimes what happens in the New York area, where the majority of us from BMW live, is that if you go into a pothole, not only do you have a flat on the front, but you have a flat on the rear tire on the same side of the car. But perhaps I think some of the most interesting things that the BMW engineers have been able to do is really link different systems in the car. I want to talk about the brakes. What they've been able, this first feature is called brake drying. What they've been able to do is link the windshield wipers with the brakes. So the car knows when it's raining. If you've ever driven out of a car wash and you first hit the brakes, what happens? Come on, this is a little active participation. What happens? It doesn't work so well. So what BMW has done, because it knows it's raining, it'll move those brake pads closer to that disc and dry them imperceptibly so that when you do have the brake, hit the brakes, they're always available. The other thing that we've added to this dynamic stability control system is something called brake standby. What brake standby does is it measures how quickly you've pulled your foot off the accelerator pedal. And if you've done that really fast, it's anticipating maybe you're going for an emergency stop. So what it will do is move, again, those brake pads closer to that brake disc so that you reduce the time of when you hit the pedal so that you have instant braking power available. Another feature that we've added is something called brake fade compensation. And if you've ever driven a car on an extended descent, you know that you don't necessarily have the same amount of braking power for how far you press the pedal at the bottom of the hill that you had at the top. So what this system does is compensate for that. So let's say you've depressed the pedal, say an inch or two, you'll always get the same amount of braking power. What the system does is compensate by that with a boost. The last thing I want to talk about is something called launch start off. Anybody from San Francisco in the room? This probably should be a standard on every vehicle in San Francisco. What it does is, again, uses the brakes. The car can determine if you're on an incline. What it will do is just hold on to the brakes for about 3 seconds. Now, this is probably not a huge deal for an automatic transmission, but in a manual transmission, you have to be, you know, quite the balancer to be able to get off the clutch, get off the brake, and get back on the gas with the outstalling the vehicle or laying some wheel. So this will help with that. What else? We have, if you could go to the next slide, Mike. Xenon adaptive headlights. Now this is a picture of a 5 Series, but the same technology applies on the 3. It'll be standard on the 330i and an option on the 325. And if you've ever been to a high-performance driving school, you're always told that when you're coming up to the corner, you want to look through the corner. First, you want to look at the apex, and then you want to look at the exit of the corner. What these headlights do is that as you dial in steering input, they'll begin to turn so that you can look through the apex and through the exit of the corner at nighttime as well. What else have we done? I said that we added a lot more features. This first one is something that Wolfgang wanted me to call triple climate control. What it is a dual climate control in the front passengers, and you have the ability to change the temperature for the left and the right passenger, and we kind of joke internally that's probably going to save untold marriages here in the U.S. And then there is a rear vent as well for the rear passengers, so if you have kids or people in the back, they shouldn't be complaining anymore as well. What else have we done? Comfort access. This is something that's fairly unique to the segment. We're going to be coming out with this in September of this year. It should be in dealerships by October. Essentially, what it allows you to do is enter the car and then start the car without inserting a key. We've also added Bluetooth connectivity. This is, among other things, gives you the ability to have hands-free use of your phone. The big difference on BMWs is that you can download your phone book. And this is compatible with most Bluetooth-enabled phones, so Sony Ericsson, Motorola, Nokia as well. We also have very sophisticated audio systems for the first time, really nice systems. The 330i's that we have for you to drive tomorrow come standard with Harman Kardon Logic 7 audio, and it's an option on the 325. On the left here, There's a picture of the center console, and then there's a red circle around it for you iPod junkies in the audience or MP3 fanatics. What that allows you to do is if you have a double-headed headphone jack, what you can do is then play your MP3 player through the car's audio system. You can't control your iPod or your MP3 player, but you have the ability to play the music through the audio system, which I think is tremendous, because as an automotive manufacturer, it's very difficult to guess what the next popular playback format is going to be, and this allows us to have the flexibility to play anything through the car. Something else is some satellite radio. You'll also have this to enjoy on all the cars tomorrow. Definitely play with it, whether you're into rock or hip-hop or jazz, country, talk, sports, it's all there. Definitely encourage you to use it. Sirius Satellite Radio has over 1 million subscribers, and we think this is something that BMW drivers will continue to ask for. Just want to talk a little bit about the buyers and then get into the pricing. About half are male, about half are female. They're very successful. But what I think is really important is that BMW drivers appreciate the driving experience. You know, they want that. That's what they're looking for. Fun to drive tends to be a top purchase reason for BMW. And then finally, they tend to be pretty demanding, both from a value and an ownership experience. So let's talk about pricing. The 325 in its base form has gone up $1,000. And the 330i has gone up just $600. But here's the value story. There's a ton more standard features, and you get that more powerful engine. And then if we look at both models on a typically equipped basis, premium package, automatic transmission, sport package, maybe on a 330i, the 325 has only increased a nominal amount, about $150, and the 330i has actually gone down in price, $100. And then the last thing I'd like to mention is just BMW is one of the few automotive luxury manufacturers to offer 4-year 50,000 miles of full maintenance, meaning you just have to put gas, and if you wear your tires out by doing too many burnouts or driving too aggressively, you have to replace those as well. But everything else is included. I think what's best is that I think that this new E90, this all-new 3 Series that you'll drive tomorrow, retains its crown really as a sports sedan within the segment. And the 330i, for enthusiasts, I think it's its most pure form. Add a sport package, you have everything you need and nothing you don't. And then for consumers who are interested in different technologies that I might add that were typically only available on cars much more expensive, we believe that will appeal to a wider audience. So I look forward to meeting more of you tonight. I look forward to the drive tomorrow. Thank you very much.
It is a magnificent road car.